On to Madison Square Garden.
Basketball with Big George Mike and his
team. Off-center from St. Louis Hawks. Jerry West from offside of the Lakers.
But I think in the long run, I'll be able to handle myself man-to-man with almost anyone in the league.
It is breathtaking in the brilliance of its athletes, passionate from the intensity of its competition, and elegant with its almost geometric precision, from the clean lines of the court to the arc of the ball to the sharp angles of the player's moves. The game of basketball played at its highest level is like a finely drawn blueprint of athletic grace, and one that clearly does not depend on language to be understood. As the NBA reaches its 50th anniversary, it has been embraced around the world with almost startling passion. But to celebrate the league and to understand its essence, it helps to know its journey. The league began in 1946, and professional basketball barely registered on the sporting map. So while the New York Knickerbockers were welcome to play in Madison Square Garden when there was an opening, if a boxing match or the circus was in town, the Knicks were relegated to play here at the 69th Regiment Armory. And that wasn't unusual. Even the Minneapolis Lakers, the best team of the time, was shuffled among three different arenas. And they were not only perennial champions, they also featured one of the era's most glamorous players, the 6'10" giant, George Mikan.
One night we were walking toward the Garden to get ready to play against the Knicks. And I looked up at the marquee, and there it says on the marquee, George Mikan versus the Knicks. And I said, oh boy, they shouldn't have done that. So anyhow, we got into the locker room, and the guys were really giving it to me, and there was no one dressing. And I said, all right, what's going on? And they started saying, well, you got the publicity. You're on the marquee. Go out there and play them. And so they really razzed me for quite a bit, and finally they decided to come along.
It was in 1891, more than three decades before George Mikan was born, that Professor James Naismith invented basketball as a diversion for his students. And for its first half century, it remained primarily a scholastic sport. Professionals played in weekend leagues and earned their keep inside wire cages and in dance halls. But in 1946, an intrepid band of arena owners decided it was the right time to start a new league.
There were hockey promoters. Wherever they had major hockey interest and a major hockey arena, they needed someone to fill some of those dates.
It was with little fanfare that the Basketball Association of America got off the ground. Its first basket scored by an unheralded New York Knickerbocker guard by the name of Ossie Schechtman.
It was a simple give and go. I made the first basket of the game. Nothing elaborate, just a plain two-point basket. That's the way we looked at it.
But the fledgling league soon realized it needed stars to sell. And merging with a rival National Basketball League, it got the biggest in George Mikan.
Mikan was very important towards the beginnings of the game to popularize it, because they were able to popularize him as a superstar.
Mikan and his Lakers were the league's premier team, winning 5 championships in 6 seasons. But the newly dubbed NBA was still far from a household name.
Someone called me and said, "Coos, congratulations, you're the number one pick of Tri-City Blackhawks." And I said, "Geez, I was a pretty good student at Holy Cross. I must have been asleep in geography. Where the hell is Tri-Cities?"
Well, I thought it was a place where they shoot people, or stop the Indians. I'd never heard of Fort Wayne. I knew of Indianapolis. I'd heard of Indiana. I had never heard of Fort Wayne.
Just getting to the game in places like Sheboygan and Fort Wayne was a challenge.
The train would go all night, and it'd go through. It would stop in Waterloo, Indiana.
And with dawn just breaking, we climbed down onto a platform. There was no overhead to this platform, just a platform in the middle of a prairie.
We would walk over to a place called the Green Parrot, a restaurant that was over there. And you'd walk in, and there'd be 4 kids that looked like Jimmy Dean, had the sunglasses on and leather jackets. And they were there. They said, "Are you guys ready?" "Yeah." And they would drive us into the Van Orman Hotel in Fort Wayne.
And that's what all the teams in the NBA did those years.
Even the games themselves were an adventure.
Syracuse was probably, I feel, the toughest place to play in the league. If you were beating their Nats, whom they love, they were just trying to come out and get you.
Going from your locker room to the floor, if you weren't challenged 2 or 3 times to a fist fight or something, there was something wrong.
I remember a guy in Syracuse called him the Syracuse Strangler.
He was about 5'8". He must have weighed about 250.
The Strangler was a guy who must have weighed 400 pounds.
And whenever a brawl would start out, he'd go out and strangle one of the other players.
We're standing in a huddle, and he just charges it right in there. So we belted him out of there.
And when he came out of the huddle, somebody must have punched him. He was bleeding from his nose and mouth, and the fans, of course, went wild.
In spite of all the difficulties, the league's pioneers were not discouraged.
We would promote. We'd go to organizations, and we'd have giveaways, and we'd really work at it.
We would go about doing as many things that we can to draw the attention to the league. So publicity was of the utmost importance to us.
We played the Rochester Royals 18 straight exhibition games before the season began. You were begging. We were all promoting and selling a sport that we hoped eventually would be successful.
But if the NBA was to forge ahead, the game itself would have to change. To counter Mikan's dominance, teams had begun to stall, resulting in all too predictable low scores.
You go out there and you play catch all day long, and the fans are in there and they say, "What am I paying to see?"
Adding a 24-second clock, however, sped up the game and paved the way for innovative new stars like the Houdini of the Hartwood.
Hi there.
Bob Cousy has dazzled countless fans with his thrilling brand of basketball.
Down to Cousy. Cousy drives in, dribble, fireman.
If George Mikan was the first great star of the NBA, then Bob Cousy was the second great star in the NBA. He was the great draw. He did things with the basketball that hadn't been done before.
I certainly was aware that my style of playing was attractive to fans in those days. I mean, what I was doing 30 years ago now, every 12-year-old is doing in every schoolyard in the country. But I was getting all the attention in the 50s because I was the only one doing it.
There were other changes as well. In 1950, Chuck Cooper, Nat Sweetwater Clifton, and Earl Lloyd became the first African-Americans to play in the league. But with Jackie Robinson having broken baseball's segregation line 3 years before, basketball's integration went relatively easily.
You know, athletes are athletes. You know, if you can play, they accept you. And any transition I had to make, the personality and the character of my teammates just eased that tremendously.
For the NBA, the most pressing issue was its future prospects.
Pro basketball is gaining rapid strides, and we expect soon to see it on the same level as pro football and pro baseball.
While the NBA was not quite ready to play on equal terms with its rivals, by the late 50s, it had managed to gain a tenuous foothold in American sporting life, an achievement due largely to the tremendous devotion of its participants.
I jumped center and took tickets. I did everything. I was the trainer, I was this, I was that, and I was the mother to the guys, and they looked up to me, but I was good to them.
One of my guys I played with, Chuck Noble, said we played for the dumbest guys that ever lived, because they didn't realize we'd have played for nothing, and we all would have.
I had broken nose, broken hands, stress fracture in the foot and things. And you just went out and played.
We were one big happy, I mean happy family.
How are you?
Okay, how are you doing?
Your ankle.
Real good.
Morning, gentlemen. Oh, Judge. Hi, Bob.
What's up, Bobby?
Oh, George. How are you, buddy?
The writers, the broadcasters, the players, the coaches, even the owners. We were all in this thing together and all looking to make it work.
With outstanding stars such as these in the fold, professional basketball should be an attraction for many years to come.
I spent a long time taking off my uniform. I could look out the door and see the guys were folding up the chairs and sweeping up the garbage. And I heard the popping of paper cups. And I began to think that there would be no more nights after the games with the guys. No more parties at the house. And no more times when my name was announced and people cheered. I cried that day. Not because I wouldn't play again. My body was hurting too much to play anymore. But because I wouldn't be a basketball player. Johnny Red Kerr played in the 50s. And those were his thoughts as he ended his 12-year career. As an announcer for the Chicago Bulls, Johnny is still close to the game. But as he took off his uniform for the last time over 30 years ago, he could hardly have envisioned the global phenomenon that his beloved league would become.
It's an unbelievable sight to be pulling into a hotel at 3 in the morning on a bus. You turn around the corner and all of a sudden the whole street is lit up. And you think, wow, they're filming a movie out here or something. Well, it's not. It's just that the Bulls are arriving.
Pardon me.
It's such a different game now because of the national and international scope.
Es el mejor canal de Chile.
Es el mejor canal de Chile.
Quiero Chile. Chao, Jackie. Gracias.
You're in Europe and people recognize you. You're in China, they recognize you. Everywhere, you know, NBA basketball. And they know all the players.
Now, let's meet 12 of the greatest basketball players in the world.
The Dream Team made basketball the game that it is around the world.
You get the feeling you're attending an exhibition, a concert, and they certainly haven't appreciated by their opponents.
I don't think anyone knew what to expect. This is the first time this has happened. But we never really knew how big that was going to become. Until we started traveling around, we see helicopters and motorcades all over the place. Hey, this is big.
It was as if it were a combination of the Beatles and Elvis on tour.
You can't get too close to Mike with the five.
Big smile? That's perfect.
NBA became entertainment. And it was perfect, too, because you can see the faces in basketball. You're close to it. There's more sex appeal in basketball.
The fans feel more than anything else that they're a part of the show. They're sitting right there. They see the players, the commitment, the joy, the glory, the frustration, the humiliation, the defeat. It's all right there.
There's no rigidity here. And yet there is some structure. And I think in America, that's really the essence of our democracy.
That's password. That's teamwork.
And in essence, it's a uniquely American game.
If a friend from Europe comes to me and says, I'm in your country, what do I see? I would say, well, go to the Grand Canyon and take a river trip down it for a couple of days and go to Chicago and watch Michael Jordan play. Just like if you went to Moscow, someone say, what? And you say, what do I do? And they say, go to the Kirov Ballet. He's who we are.
The beginning and ending of the NBA's 50-year journey provide a startling contrast. But the heart of this story, of course, lies in between. As the league celebrated its 10-year anniversary in 1956, its major concern was still survival. So when the Boston Celtics used the third pick in the draft to select a defensive-minded center from the University of San Francisco, no one hailed it as the start of a new era. He would go on, however, to virtually write the NBA history books, and his name was William Felton Russell.
I remember in my last few years, we won the playoff games, I knew that I could guard the center that I had. It was no real problem. So I started the game and I blocked his first five shots. And I had to work very hard to do that, but I wanted to do that to let him know that he was not going to be a factor in the series. Was it important to dominate? Yes. It was important to dominate because one thing that you want to do to your opponents is to make them think, make them know they can't win. We shut a guy down or block a guy's shot and say, yes, we did that to you. If you come back, we'll do it again. If you come back again, we'll do it another time. So you'll have to try something else to do. That won't work.
With his psychological approach to defense, Bill Russell helped revolutionize the game. But he didn't do it alone. He was perfectly utilized by visionary Boston Celtic coach Red Auerbach.
Styles of play have changed too.
making for a more aggressive, crowd-pleasing brand of ball. The key to this new style of play is the fast break.
With Russell controlling the backboard, we were in high gear with the up-tempo game, and we were blowing those suckers out of there.
But Russell was not only the team's catalyst, he was also its emotional leader.
Russell used to become physically ill before every ball game, and if we heard that he wasn't ill that particular night, Red Auerbach would stand up and say, "Russ, go into the men's room and throw up." That's how much he gave of himself to win.
The drama of this decade, however, came from the fact that Russell and his Celtics faced a fresh and supremely talented group of challengers. The Big O, Oscar Robertson, brought an unparalleled arsenal of weapons to the guard position, while a sharpshooting Jerry West earned the nickname Mr. Clutch. In the front court, Bob Pettit set the standard for power forwards, and Elgin Baylor made the small forward a creative force.
The collection of guys who came along at that time really changed the league, and it was tremendous for basketball, no doubt about it.
But year after year, these great stars would end their season in frustration as they watched the Celtics celebrate a growing string of titles.
West all alone. Look at Russell come down. And what a play by Russell!
And none suffered more than the Los Angeles Lakers, Jerry West and Elgin Baylor.
It's all over. The Boston Celtics are once again the world champions.
There were several occasions we thought we were going to win. We had an opportunity, but it just didn't happen.
Defeating L.A. in championship series after championship series, Boston built its fabled mystique.
We felt we were the better team, but it didn't prove to be that way. And it's awful galling for the players and I think for our management to accept the fact that we did get beat.
Although the Lakers would be their most frequent foil, the Celtics would find their most compelling challenge in one man, Wilt Chamberlain. Averaging 50 points a game for an entire season and scoring 100 in a single contest, he was the league's most unstoppable force. And as fate would have it, he played the same position as Bill Russell.
Go over the history of the NBA, the first 50 years, that's probably as dramatic a matchup as you've ever seen any time. It was like two titans of the game meeting, and you'd have headlines, Russell versus Chamberlain, and you know, the papers and the fans and everyone played this up.
They were household names. They were on the cover of magazines.
Wilt was a Paul Bunyan figure, mythic in what he could personally do. Russell, on the other hand, was part of the team, woven into the team more than anybody else ever in any sport whatsoever. It was just two entirely different ways. It was like I think when Impressionism first came into painting, and Russell was the great Impressionist painter, and Chamberlain was simply the realist, the best we'd ever had in simple, literal terms.
Russell versus Chamberlain brought the league unprecedented attention, but Wilt could not stop the Celtics alone. Three times his teams had tried to halt Boston's postseason march, and three times they had tasted defeat. But the fourth would be the most bitter, as his Philadelphia 76ers took the Celtics to the seventh game of the 1965 Eastern Division Finals.
I scored the last 10 points. We were behind, I scored 10 points, and we had a few seconds to go, and we were about ready to dethrone them.
The Celtics are leading 110 to 109. There are 5 seconds left.
We got a one-point lead, and it grabbed ball out of bounds. I did not trust anybody else to take it out but me. I wanted to take it out because I'd make sure that I could make a good pass.
Now Russell is... He loses the ball off the support. Russell lost the ball off the support. And the ball goes to Philadelphia.
We go in the huddle, and all I could say was, guys, we got to do something.
Greer is putting the ball on a play. He gets it out deep, and Havlicek steals it. Over the stand goes. Havlicek stole the ball. It's all over.
Havlicek steals the ball. I said, Havlicek, how lucky can you be?
The Celtics would celebrate at the Sixers' expense again in 1966, but in 1967, Wilt would finally have his revenge.
Well, the Celtics on a break of defeat for the first time since 1956. Gamely trying, but they did not have it here in the second half.
Philadelphia would rout Boston in the conference finals and go on to claim their title.
I'm glad I was a part of that team that brought them down. But you felt like also, well, you know, it's way overdue.
Every team in the league patterned their team to bring down the Celtics, to bring down this dynasty. And we finally brought them down. We finally brought them down.
I can remember that game when we were eliminated and the Philadelphia fans were chanting, the Celtics are dead, the Celtics are dead, they're finally dead.
Aging and injured, the Celtics did appear to have run out of time. But the heart of their mystique lay deeper than appearances.
One thing that we've always had in the Celtics is mutual respect. And we think that's the most necessary ingredient for a winning combination.
It's that feeling of giving and then supporting and then encouraging. We had that kind of care about each other.
I don't think that when players come to the Celtics initially, they believe all that pride and mystique and that type of thing. But with the Celtics, we always picked each other up.
The Celtics would regain their title the very next season. But in 1969, they would finish with their worst record in 13 years. And though they would somehow manage to limp back to the finals, they seemed to face certain defeat against a powerful Laker team that had a decade-long score to settle and a dramatic new addition.
With guys like Jerry West and Elgin Baylor, I feel very, very happy that I'm being traded to a team that I believe may stand a chance to go down on the record as one of the best teams in basketball ever.
We all felt that we had the best team. We had the best record. We beat them during the season. We were the better team.
Even as they pushed the Lakers to a seventh game, the Celtics were met only with doubts.
I can't help but wonder, how do you feel about going into another seventh game, this time on somebody else's floor?
We've done it before.
We get back out. For the last game, Jack Kent Cook was the owner of the Lakers. He put out a sheet in all the seats. When the Lakers win the championship, the USC band would play Happy Days Are Here Again. The balloons in the rafters would fall down, and Chick Hearns would interview Elgin Baylor, Jerry West, and Wilt Chamberlain in that particular order. Well, I took this back to Russell.
When the players came in, I read it to all of them. I says, there are a lot of things that's going on, but one thing that cannot go on, the Lakers cannot beat us. It's not something that can happen. They can't beat us. But it's going to be fun to watch them get those balloons out one at a time.
Don Nelson made a shot that I've never seen in all the years of basketball. It hit the rim, and it must have gone up 15 feet and came right back down through the net. I mean, it was absolutely extraordinary.
No way should we have lost the Boston. Just no way. I mean, I still don't know how we lost the Boston. It's a mystery to me.
There was something about the Celtics that made it that they had to win. They willed themselves to victory that time. And then Russell walked off into the sunset.
Now the Celtics, they have done it again. A spectacular finish.
Chris, I'm here with Bill Russell. Bill, this must have been a great win for you.
Exactly.
I know it's hard to say what's in your mind right now, Bill, and it must have been a great win.
Boy, this is such a great bunch of guys, you know. It sounds all corny, so I'm talking like that, but I told these guys before the game, I don't care what happens, I wouldn't trade you guys for any guys in the world.
As the 60s came to a close, Russell and the Celtics had won an astounding 11 championships in 13 years. And they had done it in an era that had marked the greatest influx of talent that the league had ever seen. Transcendent stars and one transcendent team had battled their way through the decade, and in the process had won the NBA a hard-earned spot in America's hearts.
Bill Russell tells a story about one of his teammates, Jim Luskatoff. He was a backup power forward who had knee and back surgery toward the end of his career. And Red Auerbach worked him mercilessly with suicide drills that left him with floor burns on his knees and elbows. And Luskatoff swore to Russell and his teammates that he would get revenge. So when his last game was over, he told them that he was going to go over to Red and punch him and to watch him to make sure that he didn't kill him. And they did watch as the hulking Luskatoff loomed over Red and began to cry and hug Red and tell him that he loved him. Because he realized that the cruel drills Red had made him endure had kept him in the league. And that was how Red showed his players how much he cared about them and how he made them winners.
Win or lose, we're taking something in that locker room and believing each other in this huddle. You gotta believe that, guys. You fought too hard. Every one of you, grab each other and trust each other.
It's a journey that begins with a single step, this 1,000-mile journey. You've got to remember that each game is that step that you take along the way.
I mean, stay tough. That's what it's about.
Let's go, guys. Let's go. Help each other. No one guy's going to join us. Go together.
How do you build a champion? Since Red Auerbach set the standard in the 60s, coaches have formed their theories. But for all their brilliant ideas, it's still more art than science. I look at the 72 Lakers. Will Chamberlain and Jerry West were in the twilight of their careers. And with Elgin Baylor having just retired, it seemed that their time for championship hopes had passed. But they came together to win a record 33 games in a row and are considered one of the NBA's greatest teams.
It was a year when everything seemed to just work perfectly. We had that opening in the clouds.
I kind of was laughing because I said, now, I can't believe this. We're winning here with all these games. I play on teams that would make this team look like nothing. And we couldn't win, you know, half the games this team would win.
Our players were at the age of their careers where everything was going to be concentrated on our team, not on individual things. It was just a sense of one person playing the game.
The Los Angeles Lakers are the greatest winning team in the history of basketball.
A cohesive team is always a pleasure to coach. But as championship teams of all eras know, chemistry alone doesn't win titles. Just ask the Houston Rockets. By 1994, they had built a strong contender around Hakeem Olajuwon. But as they lost two games at home to the Phoenix Suns in the second round of the playoffs, the Rockets had to question whether they had the drive to become champions.
Unbelievable collapse here by Houston.
We see in big headlines, Choke City, and the pressure was on us like you wouldn't believe. If we lose this series, that label, Choke, will be carried with us for a long time.
We did not lose confidence. We know for sure that if you put together and work together as a team, you can accomplish it.
There might be times when we get down, but like we've done all year, instead of pulling apart, we pull together, and we're going to get this thing done.
Putting to rest all doubts, the Rockets would roar back to beat the Suns.
The Rockets are tough. I'll tell you, they don't die.
And their stirring comeback would prove to be the turning point for their franchise.
This is one of the gutsy performances in Rocket history.
We got together and united and had the feeling it was us against the world. We were the team that just wouldn't die.
The Rockets would face seven more elimination games over the next year and a half. And every time they would find a way to win. Capturing two championships, they would take their place as one of the most resilient teams of all time.
Had non-believers all along the way. I have one thing to say to those non-believers. Don't ever underestimate the heart of a champion.
One final test of a championship team is how strongly the players believe in each other. The New York Knicks of the early 70s were a team that became famous for their unity.
There is an odd-sounding word. It is gestalt. It means a whole greater than the sum of its parts and applies, for example, to psychological phenomena in groups and to the New York Knickerbockers.
There was a thrill watching that team just because they passed so well. And sometimes the ball would kick around the perimeter and the crowd would get louder and louder as each pass happened. And when the ball suddenly went through, there was just an explosion in the garden.
But the defining moment for that franchise came in the 1970 finals. They were facing the Los Angeles Lakers of Jerry West, Elgin Baylor, and Wilt Chamberlain. The three leading playoff scorers of their time and still desperate for a title. And yet, by game five, the Knicks had managed to play them to a standstill. But then, disaster struck.
Top of the key to Reedy's triple team falls down. We got a whistle on the play, and Willis is hurt.
Even with their captain and most valuable player, Willis Reed, injured, the Knicks somehow rallied to victory. But without Willis to contain Chamberlain in game six, he shredded them for 45 points in a Laker rout, setting up the series' decisive game and one of the purest tests of collective will in championship history.
Jack, 19,500 fans here in New York City have yet to see Willis Reed at this hour of the evening.
Coming back to New York, seventh game, will Willis play? That's the question. Will Willis play?
He was the captain. In quotations, Willis was the captain. He was the guy who kept us together. Without him, I didn't think we could win at all.
When we walked in the locker room, Willis was already there getting some treatment on his leg. And I remember just before we took the floor, I said to him, we only need you for a couple of minutes, big guy.
The big question is, will Willis Reed play tonight? There is tremendous doubt right now.
This is what I dreamed about as a high school kid. This is what I worked so hard for in college. Not only me, but everybody else in that locker room. And I thought that for me not to go out there, then I would be letting him down. I wouldn't let that happen.
Here comes Willis, and the crowd is going wild.
We did
that, we said, yeah, the captain is ready.
Down court to Frazier. Left side of the lane. Outside Reed. Jumps from 20.
Willis made the first two shots, and that was it.
Barnett to Reed on the forecourt. Right side from 20. Jumps. Yes. Willis has hit on his first two.
At that point, the whole team had been lifted several levels of belief in themselves.
He puts one down court. Then his game is set to line. Fast break for the next one. Drop it down. Leads Reed the driving shot.
It was like magic.
West across the McCartan, loses to Frazier, drives ahead of the field, down the line.
What we thought wouldn't happen had happened because all of the investment each of them made in each other throughout the year came together in that game when we surpassed our individual abilities to an extent that nobody thought was possible.
That is it. The New York Knickerbockers have won the 1969-70 World Championship of Basketball.
And truly, again, our congratulations. You've offered, I think, the best that the human spirit can offer.
The league went through a lot of changes in the 60s, but not all of them showed up in NBA arenas. Basketball has always been a city game. What started to happen on the playground in the 60s, and especially the 70s, wound up changing the way it's played. Growing up here in Brooklyn, this place is like a magnet. You start to watch, and you just couldn't leave. It's like there's a whole new energy coming from the streets and going right onto the court. And though we didn't know it then, it was happening all over the country.
I come up out of the streets of Detroit. You know, we was all poor, I mean, and we had to find something to do. So we all loved the game of basketball.
Where I live, we had guys who come from different neighborhoods and different communities and try to take your court from you. And you weren't gonna let that happen.
Good defense, baby! Good defense!
We would get into a car and would go to Philly to go play against the top players there and find out who was good there. We'd go up to Washington, D.C. and play against players up there. So there was like a little cult among ourselves to move the top schoolyard players.
Once you had guys getting a reputation, a crowd started to show up. And when you have an audience, you have people starting to perform.
Watch playground players, they come with their own unique style. You got shake and bait guys, you got guys who can dunk, you got guys that can fly. People come to see action.
The kids, the people watching, also looking for something magical to happen with them. They want to see you do something that they can go back home and say, man, did you see so-and-so today? Did you see that move he made?
And sooner or later, that magic started to work its way up to the NBA.
Playground was a huge influence on everything the NBA has become. You had guys who would bring stuff that they'd learned in the playgrounds, and it would work in the NBA because you had seen it before. Almost jazz-like movements that came in the 70s to the NBA.
But the playground really started to have its influence because of the summer leagues. There was a Rutgers tournament in New York, the Baker League in Philadelphia, and the Martin Luther King League in Chicago. They had the best local talent around. And pretty soon, the NBA players got curious. So now you had the playground legends on the same court with the pros, and you could just see the game changing right in front of you.
We used to fly in during the summer months, and we would play all summer in New York at the Rutgers because we wanted to play outside. And people didn't think about knees. You didn't think about, well, you know, what about just playing ball for nothing? What are you doing this for? I mean, this was like a pleasure.
Connie Hawkins, who was then a professional of long standing, would show up at halftime and play in one of these games, and people would be hanging up in the trees, literally, or they would be crowding around these chain link fences, and it was just some great social happening was taking place.
Some of the pro players took on whole new personas. Earl Monroe was a pearl in the NBA, but in the Baker League, he had an alter ego.
That game's gonna make you disappear!
In Philly, I was known somewhat as Black Jesus, they used to call it.
You scream Black Jesus and the waters parted and everybody came through and he would come in and score 60 points and then go back through this little crowd and go back into the rim.
I'd walk in and I'd get the accolades of the whole crowd and take off my warm-ups and all of a sudden there I was and I totally played to the crowd as a guy in Philadelphia.
As you started to get more of a mix, summer leagues and the guys in the NBA, that was a perfect league for people to really develop really flamboyant moves. And those are the kind of things that you just hadn't seen in the NBA.
It took a while for playground ball to have its full effect on the pros, but when it did, it changed everything. And the guys who started all in places like this became legends.
For the NBA, the 60s were not about changing styles of play. They were about growth in popularity and size. By 1970, it had expanded from an 8-franchise, mostly small-town league, to one that included 17 teams and stretched across the country. But with Bill Russell's retirement in 1969, the sun had finally set on the Celtic dynasty, and a fresh generation of players now had their chance to stretch the game's stylistic boundaries. One of them would help reshape the league with the force of his creative vision. He would come to be known as the Doctor, but he entered the basketball world simply as Julius Irving.
I think taking the ball to the hoop and dunking the basketball, particularly against bigger opponents, was an expression of sorts. You know, if you dunk the ball over a little guy, you know, you're supposed to, right? But now you get a guy 6'10", 6'11", 7 feet, you know, you pull a playoff on him, then he's got something to think about. That was, you know, playing instinctive basketball. It was just letting it flow from you. It probably was getting a glimpse of the game in the 90s, in the 70s. So, you know, the game was probably a little bit ahead of its time.
Even before Julius Irving made his impact felt on the NBA, the climate of change was clear.
Well, I think it was an era where people were looking for individuality. People were not afraid to veer from the path and try to leave their own footprints.
Guys were more creative in a strange way. And I think that that sort of caught up in the general culture. We were looking for a little more flamboyance.
Pete was clearly one of the first mega personalities that broke onto the scene, and the way he handled the basketball so flippantly and so carelessly.
Pistol Pete was very much like a renegade kind of a radical figure. Pistol Pete took shots, made passes. It wasn't just that he did it effectively, he did it just for the sense of self-expression. I'm not just playing the ball to make the sharp pass. I'm doing it because it looks like fun.
Earl Monroe, it was swish, 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 swish. He dribbled with the ball as if it was a yo-yo.
Jerking, 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 spinning.
You had to have your own thing. Like, and you couldn't be like Earl Monroe. You had to be Earl the Pearl Monroe. You couldn't be like Walt Frazier. You had to be Clyde Frazier, like Bonnie and Clyde.
And he had like one of those sombrero hats and a big cape. So he looked like a superhero.
But it was just a general sense, I think, in America of like a more sense of, let's just do our own thing. What's that phrase? We'll do our thing. Do your thing.
But while NBA players were pushing the envelope, a young upstart league was trying to tear it open.
And now here's George Mikan, commissioner of the ABA.
You know, I've been associated with basketball all my life, and I can't remember an occasion which has given me more personal satisfaction than the basketball game you are going to see in just a few seconds.
People got to remember that the ABA was started on the idea of being entertaining.
It was wackier, more open. It had more dunking. It had the three-point shot. It had that wacky, multicolor, polycolor ball.
It's all about running and gunning and shooting more times than you. Our whole theory was, if we shoot 100 times, we shoot 130.
Here's a long lead pass, right down the lane, all the way, layup good. Oh, and Thompson. Driving to the lane, up into the air, the shot looks good.
I mean, these guys can put on a show, and in the ABA, I mean, part of the deal was the show.
And the unquestioned star of the show was Julius Irving.
And there is Julius Irving. Look at that move behind the back. Oh!
It wasn't Julius Irving. It was Dr. J, which meant when he got on the floor, on the court, he operated on guys.
Without question, without any doubt, the absolute greatest forward that has ever thrown a pair of basketball shoes.
He had this big afro. You know, his hair would always be flying in the back as he flying through the air.
He had these large old hands, you see. When he palmed the ball, it looked like a little orange in his hand.
To Dr. J.
He was, in the ABA, the symbol of the league. He wasn't just its biggest star. He was the league.
And that says everyone, really. Julius Irving.
With the Doctor lending credibility to the ABA, a competition for top talent began.
Artist, the big question here is, why did you choose the ABA over NBA?
Well, I like the colors of the basketball.
You like that better?
Yes.
And players started to jump between the leagues.
Do you know yet what you're going to do next year?
No, I really don't. Right now, I know that I have a contract.
A cross-pollination of players began, and as flashy ABA-bred stars mixed with the NBA's more traditional ones, the league's pace of change was pushed to its limit.
The basketball was kind of a stage for them to perform, as opposed to everyone kind of just playing on a team and doing their role.
Cowan Celtics would win two championships in the 70s and provide a finals series that some regard as the greatest of all time.
Garhard, turnaround, shot in the air, it's good! I don't believe it! Garfield heard in the buzzer, we've got a third overtime in a Boston Garden!
But Boston no longer set the tone for the decade. Great teams like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's Milwaukee Bucks and Rick Barry's Golden State Warriors rose up to become champions. Only to lose their delicate team balance and eventually trade their stars. Finally, in 1976, the two leagues would merge, and the NBA's balance of power shifted once again.
I'm no longer a New York Net, I'm a Philadelphia 76er, and everyone else, as well as myself, might as well get used to it.
Julius, they got this!
And the 76ers were really the team, I think, that really brought that other style, brought that other energy into the NBA. Because not only did they get Dr. J, they also had George McGinnis, who was also a very free-flowing kind of player. They had Dal Dawkins, you know, Dr. Duncan. So the 76ers were really like this traveling circus.
People used to get mad, and this is no lie. People used to get mad when they missed our layup line before the game. This is warm-up before the games. We had dunks. You see how these guys got the dunks for halftime now and the champion slam dunk? They couldn't touch the dunks we were doing back then. We were doing some crazy things.
I had the rump roaster, the bun toaster, the left-handed spine chiller supreme, the right-handed spine chiller supreme.
They are the Philadelphia 76ers, the greatest collection of individual talent ever assembled on one basketball team.
Dramatically, the 1977 finals would pit the Sixers against the Portland Trailblazers, a team built around a player who was the model of traditional basketball philosophy.
There have been basketball players more talented than Bill Walton, and there have been basketball players more unselfish than Bill Walton. But there has never been a player so talented and so unselfish.
That 77 championship series between Portland and Philadelphia was a perfect contrast. The individualism, the showmanship of the 76ers, and the quiet, reserved teamwork of the Portland Trailblazers.
Block, Walton, picked up by Lucas. Down to Johnny Davis, drives the middle. Look at the guy!
As always, the most spectacular highlights belong to the 76ers, but the trophy would go to the Trailblazers.
Here we go, the inbound to McGinnis. Drive, stop, punch, go short, no good.
I've never coached a better player, I've never coached a better competitor, and I've never coached a better person than Bill Walton.
Though Portland may have struck a blow for team basketball, Bill Walton would be lost to injury the next year, and the Blazers would be added to the list of disappearing title holders. Ironically, it would fall to the 76ers leader, Julius Erving, to take the role of NBA standard bearer.
Every city he went to was a sellout. And when you get to that arena, fans were rooting for Dr. J, but rooting for their team. And as long as they saw the doctor perform and do something spectacular, they went home happy.
He put a little extra one on that one.
But even the doctor could not stem a rising tide of NBA problems.
National Basketball Association, in its 33rd season, is troubled by diminishing crowds and declining television ratings, signs that fan interest may be waning.
You know, there's so many great players in the league now that, you know, all of them kind of nullified each other out. And, you know, what people want to come out and see now is, you know, total teamwork. And that's something I think that's really missing in the game now.
Suddenly caught in the harsh light of public scrutiny, the league saw its troubles spread off the court as well.
And there'd been so much hype about how the NBA was going to be the sport of the 70s. And then when it didn't turn out that way, people got very critical. And one thing that they particularly got critical about was that it was too black.
When the Knicks had their first all-black team, guys would say these are the Knickerbockers. I heard that comment a lot. So you had all these different undercurrents. And I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that the game was in this sort of wrenching kind of identity crisis.
The causes of the NBA's troubles are varied. 40% of all seats at NBA games are empty. Television ratings are down 18%. The crisis may not be far away.
As the NBA prepared to leave the decade of the 70s, it faced a future that appeared cloudier than it had in over 20 years. But for the lucky fans who happened to see the Los Angeles Lakers play the San Diego Clippers as they opened the season in 1979, the promise of better times was clear, and it was delivered by a charismatic rookie fittingly named Magic.
Here I am doing something I really love to do, and I'm finally where I want to be, and that's in the NBA.
But I want you to know that this man has a smile that lights up a television screen from here to Bangor, Maine.
It was a tight, tight game, and finally it came down to the last second. I can still see Kareem cutting across the middle.
To Kareem, skyhook up, and good, Lakers win!
I'm running over there, you know, full speed, I'm jumping up, I'm choking him. Yeah.
And Magic Johnson is out there celebrating like they just won the NCAA championship.
He turns so serious. He said, Bob, got 81 more games. Quit choking me.
But it was one point I think that they really realized about me was that I was going to be doing that for 81 more games.
Less than a year before his NBA debut, Magic had celebrated another dramatic victory. In one of college basketball's most celebrated finals, he had led Michigan State over Larry Bird's Indiana State and garnered national attention. Now he and Bird joined the NBA together and brought a new wave of excitement.
Magic Johnson is 6'9", lead guard. Who ever heard of things like this? Larry Bird probably should have been a power forward. He was like the lead guard. These guys changed the game.
In his very first season, the 20-year-old Magic filled in for injured center Kareem Abdul-Jabbar to help defeat the Philadelphia 76ers in the finals.
And the most valuable player is Magic Johnson. He starts at center, plays forward and guard.
And Bird would respond the next year, bringing championship glory back to Boston. It all seemed like fate. Joining Wilt and Russell's former teams, Magic and Bird gave the NBA a new marquee rivalry to build on.
That one of them was the urban black kid from Michigan, and the other one was the manure-kicking country boy from Indiana. And one of them with the Lakers, and one of them with the Celtics. I mean, that was perfect. That's central casting.
Suddenly, everything seemed to be going right for the NBA. Dr. J would team with hard-working center Moses Malone to finally win a title. And a sensational group of new stars burst onto the scene. And the timing could not have been better.
As these players were coming in, we were just seeing an extraordinary growth in television. And as people began to tune into the game, they began to realize that this was something that looked really good on TV.
And the league was changing to keep pace, showcasing its stars in new ways.
This is a tie for the money. Yo! Larry Bird!
We were expanding the game, so when fans came All-Star Weekend, they'll tell them what you would see.
Superman, get a building! Superman, get a building!
The NBA had never been hotter. Flocks of new fans were suddenly fascinated with the league. And at the heart of it all were Bird and Magic. Still early in their careers, they had already become symbols. Bird was the embodiment of basketball tradition.
The fans could sense his leadership, his hustle. He'd dive on the floor, he'd do whatever it takes.
And Magic brought Hollywood Showtime to the league.
I wouldn't do an hour series in those days because I said, I'm not going to miss those games. You just wouldn't miss them and you'd work it into your contract so you could be free to go.
In 1984, Magic and Bird would finally play for the championship. And the entire sporting world was watching.
Hey, they won the East, we won the West. So it's like everybody just get ready, sit back, and let's enjoy it.
Magic and the Lakers would capture two of the first three games.
They're running the Celtics off the Boston Garden Court.
And it looked as if they would run away with the series.
This has to be one of the most decisive routes in championship game history.
But the usually quiet Bird would issue a bold response.
You know, we got some great players on this team, but we don't have the players with the heart sometimes that we need. And today, when you see Magic slapping high fives and guys going behind their back and shooting layups on us all day long, it seems that somebody would try to put a stop to it. And until we get our hearts where they belong, we're in trouble.
Headlines the next day was Celtics play like sissies, because of what Larry said. And it was like the most incredible thing, because we saw that article and it was like we couldn't wait to get back.
Here's Kareem. To Worthy, Raymond. And you knew this was going to happen. You can see it coming.
I'm the leader of the Boston Celtics, and I knew that. My teammates knew that. So they were looking for direction, and that's what I tried to give them.
Led by Bird, the Celtics would push their way back into the series.
Here's Magic, off the mark. Lakers had several chances, and here's Larry Bird, jumping down the court.
Ultimately eliminating the Lakers in seven games.
Larry Bird, I mean, he's doing everything.
The Celtics added another championship, and Bird added to his legend.
The Boston Celtics are the NBA world champions.
I told Larry Bird, the way you played in that series, the way you conducted yourself and the way you played made me proud to be a Celtic.
You know how it feels because you've been here before. Me, I haven't scored a point.
You know? But you kind of brought the guys here that scored the points.
Well, so you're overpaid. I mean,
While Bird basked in his triumph, Magic shouldered the blame.
I had never lost in a situation like that. So that's the first time I actually had a chance to cry, you know, after the game and really say, man, that was my fault. You know, I'm sorry. You know, you turn to the guys.
But as if according to script, the 1985 finals would provide him with an immediate chance for revenge. And this time, he would be the one to rally his team.
Great assist for Magic Johnson.
We weren't going to let Larry Bird and his crew beat Magic and his crew. It was just that simple.
The determined Lakers battled to a 3-2 series lead. And in Game 6, they looked to become the first team in history to eliminate the Celtics on their home floor.
Coming in the Boston Garden and the old building and seeing Red sitting up there, just knowing that the crowd, you could just feel the crowd. I mean, everybody's sweating already. The game is still half hour away.
Though Bird and the Celtics would fight valiantly, Magic would not be denied his revenge.
This man, Magic Johnson, played this season with a mission for the Lakers, and it's about to pay off.
He would not only exorcise his own demons, but also those of Lakers past.
That whole mental and historical thing, the jinx, whatever have you, it all died at that point.
Does America believe in Magic? You bet we do.
Bird and Magic had taken a rivalry from the 60s, added the showmanship of the 70s, and created one of the most magnetic personal duels in sports history.
It was almost surreal because we were in the middle of this this great tug of war, and you really didn't have an idea who was going to win.
Okay, can we proclaim Larry Bird the greatest player of all time? Okay, I wrote that story in 85-86. Then we all watched Magic in 86-87. Well, should we rewrite that now? Yeah, I think I probably wrote that story, too.
I heard Converse made a pair of Bird shoes for last year's MVP.
Yep.
Or they made a pair of Magic shoes for this year's MVP.
Okay, Magic, show me what you got.
Each season, Bird and Magic seemed to push each other to new heights. In 1986, Bird won his third consecutive MVP and the title. In 87, Magic would be named the most valuable player, and he would face Bird again in the finals in one last battle for the ages.
When we caught them in 87, we knew they were. We were younger, and we were fresher, and we had a little bit more firepower. But they still had Larry Bird.
In some ways, Bird was never more heroic, as he desperately fought to keep his Celtics in the series. And in the pivotal fourth game, trailing 2-1, he would give Boston the slimmest of leads, with time running out.
Larry Bird with a big three-point bomb.
Day of one, Coach Riley called to play for Kareem. And I got it, and Kevin McHale basically switched out.
I saw that Magic was going to, you know, take the last shot. I could see it in his eyes. I could see him saying, like, this is not happening. And so I got to go.
5 seconds to go. Magic with a hook shot. Scores with two. After the Celtics trail by one.
It was almost over. I mean, we had one last shot. We had 1 second on the clock, and I got enough room to get it off, and I thought it was in.
Bird fires it, and the Lakers have won.
Magic's just a great basketball player. He's the best I've ever seen, you know. Unbelievable, I don't know what to say.
The Lakers have won it!
The Lakers would win another title in 1988. Becoming the first team since Bill Russell's Celtics to repeat. And by the time the 80s were done, Magic or Bird had appeared in every one of the decade's championship series, with LA capturing 5 and Boston 3. But Bird and Magic had not only dominated the league, they had also helped profoundly transform it. The struggles of the 70s now seemed like a distant memory. And two rivals who had seemed like opposites had helped bring a new spirit to the NBA that would always unite them.
They were throwing themselves into the game absolutely, totally, completely, hopelessly. And in that way, I think they kind of brought you along. They were saying, come on the court with me. I'm going to play a game of basketball with you.
They played not just to focus the spotlight on them,
but to raise the level of the game. I think they both understood that, valued it, and pursued it their entire careers, and they could not have gotten it to the level that each did without the other.
They have different personalities and different backgrounds, but their value system was identical, thinking team first and team last, and they'll go down in history as that.
Seconds are counting down on the clock. Your team is running a play that they've practiced thousands of times. It should be simple. They hit the shot and win the game. But this isn't practice. The lights are harder. Their arms are feeling heavier, and you're on the edge of your seat. Game-winning plays are one of the NBA's most enduring images. They're dramatic, and they hit at one of basketball's most essential aspects. When the game is on the line, any player on the floor can step up and decide it. Seizing the game is purely an act of will.
I pride myself in being one of the best players to ever play in this game in the clutch situation, in the pressure situation.
4 seconds, three, gotta do something, man. The Lakers win!
You're not always going to be successful, but you know, if you're scared to fail, you don't deserve to be successful.
Robinson on Barkley. It's his game to win. Barkley, 20-footer, yes!
The truly great ones, and there's very few of them, you knew that when the big game was there, you knew that they were going to be the best player.
The inbounds pass comes into Jordan. Here's Michael at the foul line. A shot on Elo. Good!
The Bulls win it! They win!
Here come the Celtics. 3 seconds. Hondo off the glass. He's got it with a second. John Hammond.
More than their statistics or even their highlights, it is these singular acts that great players leave behind as their signatures.
2 seconds. 1 second. Russ throws it up.
For Larry Bird, the ultimate symbol of his career would be provided by the 1987 Eastern Conference Finals, as his Celtics trail the Detroit Pistons by a point with seconds to go in the series' pivotal game.
On the left, it goes to Bird. Bird guarded by Mahorn. Drives around him. Goes on in. And the ball gets knocked out of bounds by Aina. No, they call it the other way.
And Detroit ball with 5 seconds to go. Thomas wants to get it in quickly.
And now there's a steal by Bird. Underneath the DJ.
For Bird, this incredible play was a crowning achievement. For Isaiah Thomas, it was something else.
Oh my! What a mistake by Detroit!
He faced the other side of history, the one that cast also Rand's aside, but also presents them with an opportunity.
The locker room was very quiet. And we were a tight team, but it seemed like Isaiah was sitting by himself. He knew he messed up, and he knew he was going to have to live with it for the rest of his life. He probably still having nightmares about it.
Isaiah, if you could, just one more time.
You see Bird coming at all?
You basically get to a point in your career when you're chasing a dream or you're chasing a championship, and you will get hit so hard, just as I got hit so hard, that you really have to, like, question, is it worth it? And you go home and you lay in your bed and you say, do I want to take this risk or do I want to be safe?
By the beginning of the next season, Isaiah's resolve was clear. But his challenge was more than just a personal one.
When you're the leader and everybody's giving you their trust and their confidence and you let them down and your confidence is shaken, theirs is shattered.
But Isaiah would rebuild their confidence with every game.
He's Thomas with a very big bucket.
We're not shooting until the final second. If I make it, we win. If I miss it, we're going in overtime.
Here's Isaiah. Let's see what he got. All the way up.
He'd see Magic, he'd see Bird collecting trophies, and he wanted to do that. There was this burning desire to want to achieve that, and that's what it takes.
Isaiah would drive the Pistons all the way back to the conference finals and pass the Celtics.
Come on, Isaiah, take it over, baby.
Isaiah sideline left pocket, four down three. Tries for a triple. It's through! With 7 seconds left, the Pistons are on their way to the NBA Finals.
Though he would fall to injury in the finals against the Lakers, Isaiah would deliver one of the NBA's most courageous performances.
And the thing about Isaiah Thomas, he's limping on every play. He is just showing so much heart and determination for the Pistons.
While Detroit would lose the series, Isaiah's heroics would not go in vain.
After the series, I think it was obvious to all of us with the Detroit Pistons that, okay, we're going to be world champions. It's just a matter of when and how many times.
Isaiah and the Pistons would have their championship the very next season.
The Pistons are the basketball champions of the world!
We're a very tough-minded group of individuals. Everything that we didn't have in talent, we made up for in determination and just sheer will.
Let's push ourselves right now.
And that strength of will would lift Detroit to another title the following year.
How many times have we seen Isaiah? He presses the inner button into heart, and all of a sudden he just takes it up.
It feels like heaven. Like the Ohio player said, heaven must be like this. Heaven must be like this.
You see, when we won championship, he was the guy that people were lifting up. Finally, he got from being the guy with the weight on his back to being lifted by the guys he was holding.
Most players would tell you that over the course of a long season, you're bound to hit some big shots and miss some others. That to find the courage to take the next one, you have to forget about the last. But perhaps the great ones don't forget. When they miss, it only makes them want to take the next shot even more.
If the NBA's story had ended with the 80s, it would have been a relatively straightforward Horatio Alger tale. Young upstart defies the doubters and achieves beyond its wildest dreams. But the 90s have added a chapter that has made it more complex. It might be titled The Journey of the Modern Superstar, and its defining character would be Michael Jordan.
And the Pistons are under a minute from getting to the NBA Finals for the second straight year.
I felt it was very disappointing each and every time that we ended up getting to this hurdle and couldn't get over it.
Well, the Pistons have moved on, but you really got a feel for this man right here.
It was such a frustrating thing for me, and I was very disturbed by it.
The Pistons return to the NBA Finals for the third straight time.
When we lost that game, I was very hurt, so I went on the back of the bus. I remember my father coming on the bus, and you know, I'm back yelling and screaming. He's doing all his best to try to calm me down and say, it's only a game, you would be given another opportunity. And I'm saying, well, we've been given so many opportunities, we're not going to get as many as you may think. And I vowed from that point forward that, you know, we get put in this position again, we would get past Detroit and go into the finals.
In many ways, Jordan's climactic moment would set the 90s in motion. But the forces that led up to it had been building since his phenomenal entrance into the league in 1984.
You had two players that played on the floor that excited you by their play on the floor, myself and Larry. And now here come one that excites you playing in the air.
Jordan, what a ball! Oh, he's in the middle open. Jordan, what a ball! It counts on a sensational clutch pass.
It gets it away to Jordan. Oh, showtime for Mr. Jordan. Jordan to the hoop.
You might see something if you watched him that you'd never seen before and you'll never see again.
Look at the air. Look at the hang time. Look at the flying motion.
He has a force of personality that's not the same thing as sports talent, but elevates that talent. If you didn't know anything about basketball and he walked into the room, you'd say, that's somebody. That's got to be somebody.
You know, he had his own particular style. He wore those baggy shorts. He was one of the first athletes to shave his head. He was so good, so charismatic, that whatever he did suddenly became popular and became cool.
That he is one of the greatest players ever is indisputable. He's also a very nice man.
But I mean, I just remember that movement, like, wow, this guy really has touched something beyond just the ball court.
But it was not only his persona. His journey also fueled his popularity.
People forget how hard it was for that guy to deal with the Detroit Pistons. You know, they were the one person that's saying, you're not so hot. You know, we can stop you. And they did.
And his struggles with Detroit only made his ultimate triumph that much more dramatic. All that was left now was for Michael to take the championship torch, and the 1991 finals would provide the perfect opportunity.
Everybody knew that it was coming. It's just when. When was he going to be ready to receive it and take it? And boy, did he receive it and take it.
3-on-2 for the Bulls. Michael on the drive, in for the right, for the jam.
I mean, he came up and snatched it. Here, give it here, Magic. It's my turn now.
And the Chicago Bulls have won their first ever NBA championship.
The quest that Michael had begun on the bus with his father was now complete. But his rise in popularity was not. As he helped the Bulls capture two more titles, his fame reached unprecedented heights. And he was not alone.
Adams to 10. Here comes Robinson.
All of the NBA's top players were now sought after by a hungry media.
Like my hat.
It's Charles Barkley.
Here comes Charles.
Jordan was a really nice guy. You know, Barkley was definitely the villain.
God wants us to win the World Championship.
I don't know if I go that far, Charles.
I talked to him the other night.
Charles is bright, and he's very funny. I think he enjoyed being outrageous.
Sometimes I dream that he is me. I just want to be like Chuck. I mean, Mike.
These players were international celebrities. Plus, they were taking the league and making it not just an athletic thing, but an American cultural phenomenon.
S-H-A-Q-I-E-M-O-U-S-E. NBA players had grown from stars into cultural icons, and it changed not only the way they were perceived, but also the way they lived.
You're my role model, right?
There are new pressures. There are new pressures from the outside. And there's so many more media demands, so many more community relations demands, so many more demands from the agent, appearances, and it just goes on and on and on. And sometimes you look at a kid about two-thirds of the way through his rookie year, and he's exhausted.
The actual games, the level of play was what I expected, but, you know, the stuff off the court, you know, I never really imagined, you know, just people knowing who you are, you know, the certain level of celebrity. You know, I'm 23 years old, and this is all, it's happened so fast, it's hard to believe.
Politicians, movie stars, even rock stars do not have to put up anywhere near what basketball stars do. You know, they watch you get dressed when you're a sports star. You get interviewed naked.
Ironically, the player who would be affected most by the overwhelming crush of attention was the one who had started it.
Before we continue tonight, a late-breaking story of enormous interest.
Michael Jordan, the best player in the country's hottest sport, the most recognizable athlete in all the world, has apparently decided to call it quits at the age of 30.
Well, it started weighing me down mentally because of all the things that were happening and some of the responsibility that I was gaining. Mentally, I was exhausted. The expectations. So I was really emotionally drained.
Michael got to a point where, he couldn't move at all. He'd go to a restaurant, he had to be isolated over to a special section just to sit down and enjoy a meal. And probably was, became a victim of his own success.
I knew mentally I was getting worn down, and I was looking for a change. So when I walked away and I finished playing my last game in Phoenix, I knew that this was my last game.
Do I have to do anything else? Can I just sit here for a few minutes?
When it came to a conclusion, I felt relieved. I felt that I accomplished what I could accomplish for this moment, and I needed a break, seriously. And that was the reason that I chose to walk away.
You miss Daddy? Well, Daddy either be home tonight or tomorrow. Did you watch the game? Who won? Chicago Bulls. Who made the last shot? John Backs. All right, let me speak to Mama.
Since George Mikan, the NBA had almost always had a strong leading man, and Michael's sudden departure could have signaled the start of troubled times. But now his peers would step onto center stage together.
You know, sometimes I kind of thank Michael for leaving a little bit, and I think he definitely helped boost my career indirectly.
Here he comes, fade away. Yes, no, it's a big one. Reggie Miller takes the bows at the stadium in Chicago.
One of the byproducts of Michael's departure was that other great players, whether it was Charles or David Robinson or John Stockton and Karl Malone or Akeem Olajuwon, became the focal point of attention.
Trying to turn baseline.
Akeem and the league's other stars provided the decade with a nice plot twist, but it would be up to Jordan to bring home the theme.
The economy has produced 6.1 million jobs since I became president. And if Michael Jordan goes back to the Bulls, it'll be 6,100,001 new jobs.
Michael Jordan announced today he's coming back to basketball. One guy said the words, "I'm back," and it set the world on fire. Just turned it upside down.
Jordan's comeback would not only be perhaps the most celebrated in all sports, but also one of the most successful, as he led the Bulls to a record 72-win season and their fourth championship.
The Chicago Bulls have regained the NBA throne.
It's been a long road. I'm sorry I was out for 18 months, but I'm happy I'm back to bring a championship back to Chicago.
But the motivation for Michael's return ran deeper than just a desire to add to his list of accomplishments.
I had some reservations about it initially, and of what people may think in terms of credibility standpoint. But the answer to that was I truly love the game. I loved the game and I missed it.
In this modern age where so much money is guaranteed, who plays well, who plays hard, who forces his teammates to play with teamwork? That seems to me an enormous definition of character.
You got it, Dennis. That's enough, that's enough.
Michael Jordan is the exemplar of the modern definition, I think, of athletic character.
In a sense, the league has come full circle. There are no more arduous train rides and dingy arenas. Today's players face a different set of challenges. But the guiding light that leads them through all the complexities that surround the game is the same as it has always been.
Well, here we are, we're playing a game, you know, and it's considered a job. It's the easiest job in America. I mean,
I can't see myself not loving the game. Even when I'm old and gray, I won't be able to play it, but I still love the game.
For 50 years, players have devoted countless hours and endless energy to realize their dream of making it to the NBA. So it is no wonder that the passion of their play has echoed throughout the league's history. You can see it in a reaction to a play or the look on a player's face as he takes the court, or simply how he talks about the game. It is these brief glimpses that sometimes provide the clearest look into the NBA's deep emotional well. And it would seem appropriate to end this story with some of them.
On this final day, there's only 24 minutes left. And it's going to be a journey that will end because I cannot turn back the clock.
I thought, you know, when I first started to play this game, it's just a game. I hope I can play it forever. But yeah, it has evolved to be more than just a game. It's been a teacher of life.
And you can see that within the way that I play.
Michael will take it. He's fouled. He's scored.
I can remember when I was in seventh grade and my parents who worked all the time and then would give up their weekends to drive me to these basketball games. And I was sitting there and I looked over at my dad and he's driving along. And I said, Dad, one day I'm gonna win the MVP in the NBA. And for winning that, you get a brand new car and I'm gonna give you that car, Dad. And my dad looked back at me and he said, what's the NBA? And my dad still has that car.
Here comes the captain, as he's done so many times.
Nothing like being in beside those four lines and doing your thing. Words haven't been invented yet that can describe that feeling that I had being on the court.
I mean, you're talking about 12 guys on both teams understanding how to play their role and what it takes to win. I wish all players had an opportunity to play in a championship and play with the Lakers or the Celtics during that time. Then they understand what basketball really is.
These are the moments, the championship moments that define the great players, the guys that are born to play basketball, the guys that are born to win.
There's no feeling like it in the world. To stand at center court with your fist raised, chills going up and down your spine, your face aching because you're smiling so much.
Best part of the game with me is playing in front of the fans. Because they knew when they came to see ice, you know, they were gonna at least do this one time. Oh, good shot. That was like.
I can't paint. I don't play the piano, and I wish I could do both. I wish I had those kind of artistic talents, but I'm a basketball lifer.
The winningest coach in NBA history.
He was the ABA. He revitalized the NBA. His name is synonymous with basketball and class. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. J.
Later on in your years, you'd lay there on the train table and you rub your leg and you say, come on, legs, come on, just give me one more game. I'll quit after this. Just give me one more game. That's all I want. You go out and play that one game. Then the next game, you'd be there on the training room table and you go, you know, I like to lie a little bit, legs, you know that, but this time I'm serious. Give me one more game. Give me one more game.
All I've heard recently is how you're going to replace Bob. That's my answer.
can't be done because that's Mr. Basketball.
Larry Bird said that there would be another Larry Bird one day. And Larry, there will never, ever, ever be another Larry Bird.
The time I spent in the locker room on the floor with my teammates was a marvelous, marvelous, wonderful time for me. From there, I couldn't go to heaven because leaving there, going anyplace else, would step down.
Through the years, the NBA has always featured individuals who personified excellence on the basketball court. To coincide with the celebration of its 50th anniversary, a panel of NBA experts named the 50 greatest players in league history. Here they are, starting with the backcourt and the greatest guards of all time. Throughout NBA history, guards have always had their own unique style and flair, but one of the position's fundamental skills is playmaking, and few have done it any better than John Stockton.
I look at a pure point guard as the guy who does what his team needs.
He did it! He did it! John Stockton, a new NBA assist king!
A generation earlier, a brilliant point guard named Lenny Wilkins followed the same philosophy. He was like a coach on the court and went on to become the league's winningest coach ever. Another great floor leader was Nate Tiny Archibald. Always a step ahead of his opponents, he's the only player to lead the league in scoring and assists in the same season.
When it was over, it was like a dream. People say, well, nobody ever did that before, and I don't know if anybody will ever do that again.
The shooting of Bill Sharman helped launch the Celtic dynasty. Back in the 50s, he was known for having the quickest shot and the quickest feet in the league. Sam Jones was another shooting star for the Celtics. The master of the bank shot, he played a key role on 10 of Boston's championship teams. But in 1967, they were dethroned by Hal Greer and the 76ers. Greer, a 10-time All-Star, helped his team become one of the greatest in league history. One year later, the Pistons' Dave Bing became the first guard in 20 years to lead the league in scoring. One of the most devastating scorers ever to play guard was George Gervin. He combined a silky smooth jumper with his patented move, the finger roll.
That's what I'm known for, you know, the finger roll. It's kind of nice to have, you know, your own shot named after you.
Finger roll, puts it up and in. No one does it better than George Gervin.
While Gervin was known as the Iceman, no one was cooler than Walt Clyde Frazier. He helped lead the Knicks to two NBA titles with his clutch shooting and stellar defense.
West across the McCormick, loses the Frazier, dives ahead of the field, down the line, layup is good.
In 1983, another Clyde named Drexler glided onto the scene and became one of the first guards to go soaring above the rim.
Drexler, he's open, he's fouled! What a show by the Clyde!
One guard who always put on a great show was Earl the Pearl Monroe. He eluded opponents and electrified fans with his whirling, shake-and-bake moves.
One of the things I learned early was how to play to the crowd. And it was very important to me because, you know, it just made my juices flow.
But the NBA's original showman was Bob Cousy. He revolutionized the game with slick ball handling and creative playmaking and ran the Celtic fast break to perfection. Maybe the ultimate crowd pleaser was Pistol Pete Maravich. The man with the fancy passes and the floppy socks was just unbelievable.
Best showman of all time. Ooh. I'll probably have to say Pistol Pete.
At 6'1", Isaiah Thomas has been called the game's greatest little man, and he always came up big in the biggest of games, leading the Pistons to two straight championships.
I was very creative with the basketball, which enabled me to basically be able to go anywhere on the court that I wanted to go, regardless of people's height.
But Oscar Robertson was the first true big guard. He used his size and versatility to dominate the court and became the only player to average a triple-double for an entire season.
And I didn't really go about to set goals like that, but I was just playing basketball, trying to help my team win.
Shooting his deadly jump shot, Jerry West averaged 27 points during his career, and the man known as Mr. Clutch always delivered.
There's always one guy late in the ballgame that seems to end up with a basketball. I was not afraid. That's when I think I had the ability to concentrate best.
2 seconds, 1 second, West throws it up, he makes it. Jerry West made it from the other side of the midcourt stripe.
In the 80s, a new Lakers star took the league by storm, Irvin Magic Johnson. The orchestrator of Showtime, he led L.A. to 5 NBA titles.
I just go out and try to play to win. And if that's magic, I guess that's what I am.
No guard has soared to more spectacular heights than Michael Jordan. Unstoppable on offense and relentless on defense.
I'm a very competitive person.
Here's Michael at the foul line. A shot on Elo. Good! The Bulls win it! They win it!
I hate to lose. I compete in practically everything, and competition is everything to me.
Whose game is it? It's Michael Jordan's game!
In the 1950s, high-scoring Dolph Shays made the Syracuse Nationals one of the NBA's top teams. He also played in 706 consecutive games, making him basketball's original Iron Man.
I had the ability to hang in the air.
Pigeon Paul Arizin was a two-time NBA scoring leader. His jump shot took the game off the ground and changed the way it would be played. Mixing talent with tenacity, Bob Pettit was one of the league's greatest forwards. Over the course of his career, he averaged 26 points and 16 rebounds. But Pettit retired at age 32, saying he could no longer meet his own high standards. Taking the forward position to a new level was Elgin Baylor. An explosive scorer, he also had the ability to float in midair, bringing a totally new dimension to the game.
I just play the only brand of basketball, the type of basketball I knew how.
But looking back today, over 23,000 points and 11 All-Star appearances later, perhaps not even Elgin himself is sure exactly how he did it. The 1960s also brought the arrival of Jerry Lucas, who turned the blue-collar work of rebounding into an art form. In Philadelphia, Billy Cunningham delivered offensive firepower for the 76ers, averaging 20 points and 10 rebounds a game over his illustrious career.
I always felt that, I could run and run and run, and someone told me one time, you will pass out before you injure yourself.
And John Havlicek kept on running for 16 seasons, his tireless play earning him the nickname Hondo. When he was through, he'd scored over 26,000 points and starred on 8 Celtic championship teams.
Hard, Greer's putting the ball in play. He gets it out deep, and Havlicek steals it over the sand goal. Havlicek stole the ball. It's all over. It's all over. Jerry Havlicek is...
Entering the 70s, Elvin Hayes ushered in a brand new era for the NBA. A power forward who played with finesse, the Big E was one of the league's most dominant and durable players. When the New York Knicks acquired Dave DeBuscher, they found the missing ingredient that produced 2 NBA titles. One of the game's standout defensive forwards, DeBuscher controlled the boards and was also a clutch player on offense for those Knicks teams.
When I was out there, I was in another world. I was totally immersed in that world. All of my focus was there.
Rick Barry brought a world of skills to the forward position. During a brilliant 14-year career, he excelled in every phase of the game, once even leading the league in steals. But above all, he was an offensive machine, and he is the only player to have ever led the NCAA, the ABA, and the NBA in scoring. With an improvisational style all his own, Julius Erving was simply the doctor. He stretched the game's creative limits and seemingly defied the laws of gravity on his way to becoming the third leading scorer in basketball history.
I really considered those routine plays, although I know they were beyond the boundaries that one would call fundamental.
The evolutionary trail of forwards continued with Boston's Kevin McHale, whose twisting, contortionist moves in the low post completely frustrated his opponents.
He used his worm move.
There was the sleek yet powerful quickness of the Lakers' James Worthy, so often found at the finishing end of a Showtime fast break.
Inside Worthy, he's at it.
The emphatic deliveries of the mailman, Utah's Karl Malone.
Ah, moved by the mailman.
The dynamic athleticism and versatility of Chicago's Scottie Pippen. And the irresistible force known respectfully as Sir Charles, Charles Barkley.
Play by Barkley!
I've always felt that anytime I step on a basketball court, if you give it 100% every day, good things are going to happen.
And now there's a steal by Burke. Underneath the DJ, right in the net. What a play by Burke!
They said he couldn't run and couldn't jump. But what became evident about Larry Bird was that he also could not be stopped.
If it comes down to one shot, I want to be the guy to take it.
Bird goes for three.
It is just a 16 by 18 foot area. But in this small space, reputations and legends are made. It has been the domain of many great NBA centers, beginning with the league's original superstar, 6'10" George Mikan. He led the Minneapolis Lakers to 5 championships, earning the nickname Mr. Basketball. 20 years later, another towering center was making a name for himself, a player who seemed virtually impossible to stop.
He presented me for the first time in my career of basketball, a guy that I really need some help to guard.
Kareem Abdul-Jabbar used his graceful skyhook to become the league's all-time leading scorer. He left with 6 NBA titles and 6 MVP awards.
The thing that amazed me the most about him was his strength. He was an incredibly strong and powerful performer.
The respect between Bill Walton and Kareem was mutual.
It was a very competitive atmosphere when I played against him. I thought when he was healthy, he was definitely one of the great centers to play the game.
Walton won NBA titles with both the Trailblazers and the Celtics, where he teamed up with another star center, Robert Parrish. With his steady, all-around skills, the Chief helped revive the Boston dynasty in the 80s. He became one more link in the chain of Celtic greats, following in the footsteps of Dave Cowens.
The way I played the game was just play it as hard as I could all the time, no matter who I was playing against.
The man known as Big Red played a blue-collar style. His toughness and hustle made him a favorite of Boston fans. But some of his fiercest battles came against another bruising center, Wes Unseld.
My style of play and his style of play, I think, were somewhat compatible in that for 48 minutes, you and I were going to knock heads. If you had something weak about you, I was going to exploit it and make it weaker.
Here comes Willis, and the crowd is going wild.
In one of the league's most dramatic moments, Willis Reed limped onto the court for Game 7 of the 1970 Finals. Inspired by their captain, the Knicks won the title. And throughout his career, Reed left a legacy of courage and determination. Joining Reed among the league's greatest centers is Nate Thurmond. His trademarks were his outstanding defense and rugged rebounding. And just as he was leaving the scene in 1977, a new star was arriving. His name, Moses Malone. His relentless work ethic helped make him a three-time MVP. And in 1983, he won a championship with the Sixers. But Moses would pass the torch to the next group of dominant centers, four young stars who would stake their own claim to greatness. Patrick Ewing and Akeem Olajuwon each made his team a championship contender. And in winning back-to-back titles, Akeem also won the admiration of his opponents.
If I was to be compared to any center now, I would love to be compared to Akeem.
Shaquille O'Neal arrived with devastating force and an awesome combination of size, strength, and agility. In San Antonio, David Robinson brought a variety of skills rarely seen in a big man. The centers of the 90s seemed ready to conquer the world, a feeling echoed many years earlier by a brash young star.
In the long run, I'll be able to handle myself man-to-man with almost anyone in the league.
Wilt could always back up his words, scoring 100 points in a game and rewriting the NBA record books. He was the league's most dominant offensive force. But the ultimate test came whenever he faced the game's greatest defender, Bill Russell.
You have no idea how physically imposing he was. But I never considered a threat. It was just a challenge.
Russell left an indelible mark on the game, and he built his reputation on defense. He was the master of the blocked shot, a ferocious rebounder, and he triggered the famed Celtic fast break. But most of all, he was a winner, leading Boston to an astounding 11 NBA titles in 13 years.
How do years go by? You know how tears to my eyes. Pour through the changes, the soul never dies. We fight, we laugh, we cry as the years go by.
As the years go by.
And if we lose our way, any night or day, then we'll always be where we should be. Changes, the soul never dies. We fight, we laugh, we cry.